Oh, hello, hello, everybody, beautiful, powerful ladies all over the world. This is Lana Elko and our interview with our amazing guest, empowered woman, my dearest friend, Hollywood actress and author, and advanced world therapist. Lots of information, and we'll go through all these things. It's all these things are very exciting, and Sammy, you know, she inspired me with many things when I met her and we became friends. So there is an opportunity to watch us live. If you watch on replay, that's totally fine. You can always you know, share your emotions with us, this the energy and exchanging in energy together, and you can ask all the questions even if you're watching on replay. I know, like, some of you different parts of the world, different parts of the day, so that's totally fine. You can still leave comments, we'll come back to you and answer all the other questions, or just share whatever feels right for you. So I just give you a little bit of history. We met with Sammy a few years ago. How, like 5 years ago? I don't remember. It was a while ago, through holotropic breathwork training. It was growth transpersonal training. You know, some of you know that I do breathwork, and it was life-changing for me. And holotropic breathwork is part of transpersonal psychology. So this is what Stanislav Grof and Christina Grof created. So this is how I met Sammy in training. And, you know, we just got, you were my first sitter, right? That was just amazing, just came to my mind. So we just connected right away, and we were sitting for each other. That was that this is how we do it, and holotropic breath work, sitting for each other 3 hours while another person is breathing. So this is how we became friends, and we kept coming back and meeting each other, and came to visit Sammy in Los Angeles, became friends with Michael, her partner, and they now both are facilitators and do holotropic breath work workshops. But there is so much to share about Sammy, and she's originally from Japan, and she moved to US and became Hollywood actress, and she's also an author, and she does this amazing transformational work that I would like you to learn about, because I was pretty fascinated about this particular modality from Japan. It's called Advanced World Therapy, and Sammy will tell you more about it. So let's give a word to Sammy, and maybe Sammy, you can share more about yourself and about your story when you made great decisions to move to the US, became an actress, became an author. So tell us a little bit more about your story and share with us.
Okay, yes, hello everyone. First of all, it is a theory. My teacher developed a method, was called the theory of an advanced world, TAW, we call it Tao. Yes, so it's a theory, but it's just fascinating, mind-boggling. But I'll talk about it later. But first, by introducing myself, I would like you to get to know me a little bit. So I was born and grew up in Tokyo, and my life was fairly good, very comfortable life I had. But then there was always like an innate voice saying, is there anything more to life? And who am I? Because ever since I was little, all I did was just to try to be a good daughter, trying to be a good student, and trying to be a good girlfriend, and friends and colleagues. And then so cluster of those roles that I was trying to, you know, play very well, but I did play very well. But then when I had a boyfriend who wanted to marry me, then my thought was like, okay, so I'm going to try to be a good wife, a good daughter-in-law, and then someday I'm going to try to be a good mother. And this huge question came out, like, oh my God, who am I? So that just put me on the quest of searching for self-discovery. And so I wanted to, before I get married to my ex-boyfriend, I decided to take some time to develop myself, to get to know who I am. So I just searched for a lot of stuff that to reading successful people's like a bio, especially women successfully and then like a thriving in their business or lives. And then I wanted to get, you know, inspiration from them. So, and then, but one article that I read was from actually, he was an actor in Hollywood, and he said when he's really getting into his character and he's, it's so-called like in the zone of flow, he said that he feels like he's aligned with the universe. He becomes a part of the universe and oneness or something like that. And then I thought, oh, I want to have what he's having. So I chose to come to Hollywood to start taking acting class and to get to know myself and to be more comfortable in my own skin. So that's how I started acting training. And I didn't have any desire to, you know, become an actress and start earning living, you know, through acting at that time. Because I didn't even speak English well. So I came here, but my desire to really get to know myself. And then I just wanted to find out the strengths that I have, how much strength and ability that I have somewhere inside of this little body. You know, there has to be something more. So as well as looking for the answer outside, I was always searching the answer inside of myself too. So that I put myself through acting, and then I was very inspired by, you know, aspiring actors, actresses in my acting class. And then I started giving myself a little, like a milestone, like an assignment. And then I was just really striving just to put myself 100% to, you know, go one step at a time. And then I started making living, and I never waited on table, and I was making living through acting and writing, doing commercial work and a TV work, movies and voiceover work. And then I even bought myself a house in Hollywood Hills. And it's just all for the focus and determination and wanting, this desire that I want to give myself house. I want to give myself an opportunity to become a homeowner, because I was so jealous of all these people who seemingly doing better than I do. Yes. But this wanting fire was always inside of me. And I would say that my success was just to really listen to myself. I want to go there. And then I focused that, you know, 100%, and then cut off the option to just to become a victim of fate. I was always a trooper. So, but outside of me, I was doing very well. But then my internal world was completely opposite. I had this really negative self definition that I'm not good enough, and I'm not smart enough, I'm not pretty enough in Hollywood, and I'm not tall enough. And so that was a huge struggle, and no one understood me well. And then when I complain, people perceive me, my friends are like, oh, she's just complaining. Yes, that's how I was perceived. But so internal world was just a very, had a negative worldview. And because I had the self-definition that I have to fight in order to get what I want. So my worldview naturally became like a war zone. It's like a battlefield. I have to go out there, like auditioning, you know, I have to go out there just to fight. and prove that I am the best, you know, than anybody among all the people, hundreds of people who come to audition for one role. I had to be the best. And then it was just a really, really tough for me, because almost like walking into the casting office was like walking into this gladiator match. And then when I mess up my audition, I would really punish myself that, see, you know, I'm horrible. And because my definition, my worldview was, the world is a battlefield. I have to fight to get what I want. So that even casting director gives me little notes like, oh, okay, that was good, but then try this way and that way. And I would take it as a criticism. And then I was just shamble. And I just can't think anymore. So I was just going through all those workshops and, you know, self-help workshops and seminars, self-development seminars and motivational seminars and all those things. I tried a lot of things like Ho'oponopono, theta healings, pranic healing, and then a lot of things just to heal myself. And why do I have to fight? You know, can I be more in harmony with whatever happening in my world? And nothing really worked for me. But then when I started breathing through holotropic breath work, I started getting amazing healing, inner healing. I could connect with it. Because during the holotropic breathwork session, we could get into this expanded state of awareness. And then mm-hmm. I started seeing, visually receiving, perceiving my self-definition, almost like my past life. And then I was a wounded soldier in some time, like a medieval time, and I was a wounded soldier left alone in a battlefield, almost dying. And there was a guy who trained me to become this fierce killer, and then who was like my father figure, who came back on a horse just to look for me. So among all those corpses around me, and I just you know, wanted to him to find me, and I'm still here. I'm still alive. Just, you know, take me home. But then he had this blank face, and then he just saw me, and then no expression, this cold expression, and he just turned around his horse and then left. And that was just heartbroken for me, and I was left alone, dying. And so, but then that was my self-definition. I was kind of had like, I'm unlovable. I'm abandoned. I was abandoned by my parents emotionally. But then through holotropic breathwork also showed me completely opposite perspective. So next time I did, I was in this other guy's body and saw my body completely dead. And then I thought I was still alive, but from his perspective, general, who was my father figure, his perspective was like he saw me dead. And then at that moment, his heart was broken. That's why he mm-hmm. couldn't, he was had this blank, cold expression. His heart was broken. And then, and when I understood that, like a complete 180 degree different perspective, when I gained this inner healing happened all of a sudden, I felt I was left alone, abandoned. But no, there was a guy who came back to find my body, hoping that I was still alive. And when he found my body dead, his heart was broken. And then, oh my God, there was love. There is love. And then inner healing happened. And then that perspective gave me the understanding like, oh my God, I'm just trapped in my own stories. And then I found I met Mao Ishiki, who was the founder of fractal phenomenology as well as the theory of an advanced world. And what it is that, can I keep going or just I should stop?
Okay.
So what she offered was that it's a fascinated study program that she was also searching for almost like a meaning of life, the mechanism of life. She's more like a scientist in her brain. So, and she was searching for the answer, and then her brain was developed to a certain level that she started really seeing the thoughts creates reality. So it means like she decoded the mechanism of how our thoughts turns into so-called tangible reality. And that's, she made it a study called the fractal phenomenology. So scientifically, she describes, explained how our thoughts turns into material. But it was really hard to absorb for most of us because our brain is not developed to understand that level. So she created this study course called Theory of an Advanced World. Now in Japan, people call it fractal psychology because brain, what our brain does is that all this information we have already, we just project it out there as a story and then perceive it. That's why it's called the recognizing. It's like a recognizing it because the brain doesn't recognize it doesn't already have it in our brain. So basically what our brain does is create a story, which is like a, you know, thinking pattern or neural wirings, and project out there, and then just recognizing it. And then with five senses, you know, we feel like it's my experience. We experience it as like tangible experience. But Mao discovered was, you know, these days, like the last 30 years of science also backing up this theory that, you know, there's actually nothing out there. It's only our brain perceives and then categorize it in the process as if, and then we feel it with five senses. Those information is more constrained when we are awake because of our five senses. We constrained those informations and then make it into our experience. So, and then some of the neuroscientists these days, they call it like reality is a controlled hallucination. And 2600 years ago, in India, there was a prince, Siddhartha Gautama, later on turned into a Buddha. He stated this teaching. Now it's called the Heart Sutra, which is the most known Buddhist text in the world. And Heart Sutra describes the life as it's utterly unsubstantial. It's completely empty. It is a pure illusion. And so in 2600 years later, science is catching up. And then they're telling this is like controlled hallucination. And the mechanism is not 100% discovered. It's just really the beginning process of how the consciousness works, how the brain works, and then they're in the quest of discovering it. So it's just a fascinating time we've been living right now. But my question became through Tao, so if my thoughts, accumulated thoughts, create my reality, then how can I change my reality by changing the way of, you know, new way of thinking? And then I have been developing, designing, taking in some principles from holotropic breathwork, as well as some principles from Tao, theory of an advanced world, and designing a course. And then my counseling method is just to really, first of all, like, heal your brain first, and then start guiding my clients to consciously create a neural wirings so that we can start producing or projecting the future or reality that I want to live in, they want to live in, like a desired future we can create with this new neural wirings. Because we have, you know, we assume when we grow up, growing up, become adult, our brain becomes adult too. And that is really not the case. Yes, we still have a child mind, as we call it, child mind. This is my little drawings. It's like our brain here. The child mind is developed. Oh, the thinking patterns, neural wirings, thinking pattern is just stored in here, which was, you know, developed when we were born to 6 years old. And then there is a part of brain just after 6 years old, it starts, you know, growing more, neural pathways are growing and expanding. And then so-called the adult mind will be matured around 25 to 30, like we start using more frontal cortex, which is more logical, factual, problem-solving part of our brain. But we assume that our brain is adult, but then this child mind still remains. And this is I will guide my clients to create the neural bridge here. So from adult mind to child mind to access to it, and then like soothe it, and then really start taking care of it, like a parenting, taking care of it, and then, yeah, and comforting it and encouraging it. And then sometimes we have to be, no, we have to go, let's go. You know, you should stop whining. And then, yes. And then, so that's the method that I learned from Tao. And also I am offering my clients, so people come to me and Michael's workshops, and just to guide them and then support them to start creating these neural pathways consciously. And we are seeing amazing results in our clients. And so, yes, I'm just really feel very privileged to do this, to share this knowledge and technology to people. And then as I guide people and support people's growth, growth of neural pathways, I also, my brain gets developed too. So it's purely just a win-win situation. And I just love to share my knowledge and my technique. So, and that's, yes. And then unless, you know, your child mind really finds its mom, you know, parent, this part of us, we all in our brain, this will be keep looking for, you know, love and affection, approvals and validations in the wrong places. And so that's why it's so important to find, you know, let your child mind find your own mom. It's already in us, and then connect it.
Yeah.
And then we learn how to parent and how to parent my own child. The reason I felt that I started doing this work, and I really started thinking, like, the reason I don't have, you know, children, I don't have a child, is that one of my life purposes is to really parent my own inner child and just raise myself. And then hopefully I become example for people that whether you are a mom already or not, or you want to become mom in the future, this is the most important relationship, you know, that you need to have and establish and then nurture with yourself, your inner child self, and then learning how to parenting, you know, your inner child or inner child mind. It's just so empowering, because we be looking for love and affection, approval outside. And no, we don't need that. We have everything in, you know, in us already, like divine intelligence and this higher intelligence, and then just this magnificent ability and unlimited potential. So we are all born with them, but we just don't know how to access it. We just forget, like, we even have that, and then looking for things outside of us. And so that, yes, my guidance is that really just really start looking into yourself. So that's why this is inner work, we call it inner work. And but the most difficult thing for us is that this is a continuous work. It's never end. And because when you think like, oh, I'm good enough, and this is it, then when brain thinks like, you know, oh, this is it, I don't get any more new information, means like, you know, brain stopped receiving stimulation. Mm-hmm. And that's a dead zone for us, mm-hmm. for brain. So we need to keep this, we have to cherish our curious mind, mm-hmm. you know, and wanting and our desire. This child mind is always wanting. It's full of desire, want more and more and more.
Yeah.
Which is great, because wanting is a life force.
Yeah.
So life force. And then if, you know, if we consciously use it, you know, it could turn into passion, a fire in your belly, and just move forward. Or, you know, motivation and your drive to move forward, and then build the life and reality you want to live in, and produce something for yourself and for your family, for your, you know, beloveds. And then it's amazing power we all have. But if it's not guided, this one is not guided well, then it's not used for, you know, constructively, outwardly, creatively, you know, intentionally used, you know, produce, you know, used outwardly, then it'll turn around and become very self-destructive power. That's what I was doing for a long time. And that destructive, like, thinking patterns really, mm-hmm. you know, it's developed into my eating disorder and the suicidal thoughts that I was kind of playing with it over 10 years. And it was a really, really difficult time that I had to go through. But it's all about, you know, in our head, like a thinking patterns, we get trapped without knowing, we get trapped in our own, you know, stories, which was created when we were really, really young. We saw our world, which is the world, you know, for little children or toddlers, is a world, is a family unit. And then with this very immature, limited perception, because even adults, we have a very limited perception that what brain can perceive is less than 5% of what's really out there. And then just take a few information. Brain is very self-serving. So, you know, brain picks up certain familiar information outside and then put it in our brain and then categorize it. And then there's only certain categories in our brain. And then you just put it and then process it. And then, like, reinforce the idea, like, see, I'm unlucky. See, this always happens to me, you know, or it never happens to me. It's always for other people. And then just reinforce what brain that doing is reinforcing your self-definition. That's why this, when I was doing some spiritual practice, you know, I was reading this sentence like, your world is a mere reflection of how you think about yourself or how you treat yourself, how you like yourself. And so that's really what you think about yourself is projected out there. And then brain is diligently just choosing, selecting information to take it back in, to recognize it, to reinforce your definition of who you are. So in order to change your definition, you know, this is the practice. This is how you know, change your, modify your neural pathways or thinking patterns. It's almost like a thinking habit. And in order to change your habit, at first you need to know you have the habit. So breath work helped me was like I could step out of my own story and see myself like, oh my God, I was living in my, all my life, I was just living in, you know, trapped in my own story, just repetitive stories over and over and over. I was a victim, you know? And so first we step out of our own story and see, oh my God, I don't like that story anymore. So let's just, how can I change it? That became my question. And then my quest of searching, how can I change my stories? And then I want to create this beautiful stories and then, you know, just powerful, become a powerful woman and well balanced, you know, with well being and then connecting to people and then expanding my outside, you know, reality, you know, connecting with all these people and empowering each other. So that's what I'm at.
Well, this is amazing. I'm just like, it's mind blowing. It's very powerful and it's very full. Like, it's a full story of your journey, and it's very inspiring, especially for women. You know, this we're doing this interview in the group of women, so maybe we can. I'm curious, how do you connect like your the whole story with the like this awakening of the empowered feminine? Like, this is something that I'm focusing it. And of course, all these elements that you mentioned, I saw that law of attraction, you know, that's another, it's more mystical approach to, you know, to kind of explain the same phenomena that you were, your way like is more scientific, which is, I find it fascinating because it's like connects the points, it connects the science and, you know, spirituality finally together, and then inner child work. Like, this is something so big when so much healing happened, and then the receiving piece when we like we start to receive our own story and see it from outside, right, through breath work and expanded state of consciousness. So all this, like, I was like, wow, this is happening in different form, but it's like all one of the same process of our evolution. So my question is to you is about how do you connect your work now with awakening of the empowered feminine, and how it's different? Because I've heard some at the beginning when you shared when you came to the United States, and you know, you had the burning desire, which is kind of the, very important for us women, but then you were like really struggling, and you saw your life as a like a war zone, right? And it was kind of masculine way, like the whole, because the war also, it's a collective, right? We can put ourselves out there, and it's very, the system itself, it's very masculine. So how did you, how your story and vision about this piece has changed since you started to do this healing work? How do you connect it with integrating that feminine piece, which is more, you know, allowing and receiving and seeing it as like this intuitive knowledge that we receive, not just like what we analyze, yeah, right, from what we know rationally. Can you share a little bit about how you feel about this?
Yes, I think the balance of it, and we have everything. We feel like there's something lacking me. Maybe mm-hmm. that masculine strength, and then, you know, and but we do have everything. And so in order to discover it inside of you, you know, that's a inner work. But in my case, I was really, you know, I look feminine, and but what I recognized was that I have so much anger. Like mm-hmm. I think we all have anger. And then it shows in a kind of disguised way. And mm-hmm. but yes, when we were born, we always feel anger. And then that's stored in us, because when we were in the womb, you know, all needs are met, everything is taken care of. You don't have to do anything in mom's womb. You had the absolute existence, you know, your own mom's, you know, womb, and then everything. You don't even have to ask for the food, you know, just it comes to umbilical cord, and then everything was taken care of. But as soon as we get born, like, what is this? I didn't sign up for this. Like, you have to, this discomfort, the newborn baby, the first thing babies, like I or everybody experience is a lack of comfort, lack of protection, lack of safety, and lack of nutrition. And then we learn, and then this is how our neural pathway starts developing. Like we learn that we have to use our energy outwardly in order to get what I want, means like for survival. And so, you know, for it is all survival. So we're all animals. So we, our autonomic nervous system called fight or flight reflex starts kicking in. And we start projecting our energy outwardly by crying. So, and then trying to get attention, and then do something with my diaper, or do something, I'm hungry. So by crying, so the babies are now sad, you know, crying. Babies are angry. Do something for me. This is unreasonable. I didn't sign up for this. So, and so we have, everybody has this innate anger, you know, which stored in our body. And this certain amount of anger, you know, becomes, like I explained before, you know, becomes passion or fire or drive and those things. But if it's not used, it becomes destructive. But in order to, what was the question, Lana? I forgot.
How do you connect with this awakening of the feminine? Because, we're a women's group, and is there any difference in like masculine and feminine and your work? And how do you, maybe also connecting is with the collective, because there's kind of, well, I feel we talk a lot about awakening of their, you know, mm-hmm. mother of energy or empowered feminine, that mm-hmm. nurturing, beautiful, you know, loving, and not seeing as it was competition, but like bringing things together. So so that was basically the question. Yeah, how do you see it in your mm-hmm. is there a difference?
Mm-hmm. Masculine, so feminine power is that we were all once in mom's womb, one point. And then the reason we are alive is that because our mom did something right, you know, more than right, more than enough work they did, so that, you know, we survived, we're alive. And then we have this healthy brain that now we can watch this video and understand it. And then, you know, you have a job and you make your living and you can think. And so because our mother did something wonderful for us, and or your caretaker, or it might be your father too, to raise you. But our baby brain doesn't register norm. That's mm-hmm. why nobody remembers how many times You know, even once we don't remember that my mother changed my diapers out of 4,000 times, 3,000 times she's done, changed my diaper. And, or I don't even remember, nobody remembers even once that your mother held you close to her skin and nursed you out of thousands of times she's done for you, because we don't have our child mind needs so much stimulation. So it just needs unusual information as a stimulation, and then just stores it to create the neural pathways. And then it just doesn't have much space for the sensation, which is mundane, ordinary, everyday activity. So that's why we don't remember the amazing works that our mother did for us, gave us. We don't really recognize it. So just by developing, you know, do this inner work, doing this inner work, and really parenting your child mind, you know, we need to use our imagination, you know, our intuitive, you know, senses, that what my inner child needs, and then how I need to discipline right now. And sometimes discipline, you know, disciplining children is a form of love. It's not easy. It's not easy, but sometimes we have to do it, because true love is really support your partner or your child, support this person's growth so that your child will become independent, responsible, you know, adult, you know, and member of society.